I'm losing my self-control. It is starting to trickle back in. But I don't wanna fall on the rabbit hole. Cross my heart, I won't do it again.
You know, one day I was thinking, if it's my last lecture of the quarter, I can be like that, right? In a concert hall, and we have perfect light, and we have a lot of you like feel very excited, right? It's finally the end, right? But seeing the attendance today, I think it's probably hard to happen, at least for a foreseeable future. But today, also in the last lecture, we talk about the dark silicon problem. It seems like our future is pretty dim, but today I'm going to show you is actually starting of the golden age of computer architecture, and I'm going to tell you why is it happening, or it is already happening. So, but before we start, last lecture we talked about, you know, because of the adoption of multi-core processors, right now when we are optimizing cache performance, there is one more type of cache misses that we have to deal with, that is coherent miss. And it's coming from the fact that we have false sharing. So It's very, very complicated in the era of multi-core programming that you need to know. Well, there is an issue, even though I'm not really sharing the data, there is still a problem. And as a result, if you look at this question, the right-hand side and the left-hand side, they have no difference in computational complexity, and both of them would give you the right result, but the right-hand side would give you twice better performance simply because it eliminates all the coherent misses. But even though we optimize for that, there's no guarantee that you can always get your right result because it's very difficult to maintain the consistency of your program. Some of you say that, what if we put locks everywhere? But the problem is that if you put locks everywhere, you are basically serializing your program and making no use of your multi-core processors, and just a waste of time, and it's even slower than your single-threaded program. If you don't believe that, go look at your assignment 4. That's what we didn't want to tell you, right? So for this particular question, you will see all 4 types of output are possible. But even though, and part of the reason is because, well, first of all, we have non-determinism among the execution order of your program. And the other thing is that even though the thread execution is in the order that you want, however, there are out-of-order scheduling mechanisms that would help us, to optimize the single thread performance, but lead to the result that we don't want. So it's very difficult. So to be honest, I feel a little bit sad in the parallel programming part. I demonstrate more drawbacks than benefits, you can see, because processor behaviors are non-deterministic. So even though you see speed up in some cases, but you cannot predict, because you cannot predict the order. So when you program, you have to be really careful. And cache coherence already guarantee that everyone should see the same value at the same time, but not when and how it evolved. And cache consistency is the protocol that supports that. But if even though we try our best to use relaxed consistency support by modern processors, it's still difficult to make it behave as you predicted. So then we switch our gears a little bit to talk about why we are entering a Dot-Sigmund problem. It's not because of the slowing down of Moore's law, and in fact, the slowing down of the Moore's law is not a limitation. We are still allowed to put more transistor within a chip. What really prevents the semiconductor industry to go with the growth of Moore's law is actually the broken of Dynodian scaling. So in the past, with Moore's law, with Dynodian scaling, we are allowed to scale down the power consumption per transistor with your chip process technology. But when it is broken, which is the world that we're living now, even though you can shrink the size of your transistor, each transistor is effectively consumed the same amount of power as the transistor sized as the past. So it turns out that within the same chip, you are going to generate more heat, more power consumption, which makes your system difficult to power up your chips and perform heat dissipation of your chips. So it turns out that we are entering a dark silicon era where even though you are given a big chip, you can only use part of it, or you can only have them running in a very low power mode. So that's the problem that we are hitting. So today we are going to talk about, we are now in the dark silicon era, but how does that lead to the golden age of computer architecture? So the first thing that I want to talk about, because we are now in the dark silicon era, so you will see a lot of computer architecture innovations just because we want to address the issue in dark silicon era. So I've categorized the solutions we have into 4 different trends. The first one is aggressive dynamic voltage frequency scaling. And the second one is that when we design computer architecture, we become more throughput oriented instead of focusing on single thread performance. And then the third one is just we accept the fact and we just let the silicon dark. And the final one is that because we have no way to build fast general purpose processors. So we instead try to spatialize the hardware. So the first trend is aggressive dynamic frequency scaling. So you must already experience that when you are doing your assignments. So for example, this is the Intel processor that I use for most of the class demo. If I do an LS CPU, you will see the frequency is jumping between 800 and 5 gigahertz, 800 megahertz and 5 gigahertz. So it's a huge range. And at the time that I grabbed this graph is at 1.2 gigahertz. And if you look at the spec, which you can find it here, it's also identical to, or say very similar to, the ones that I got here, is that there is something called Intel Turbo Boost Max technology, and there is something called Max Turbo Frequency, which is consistent with your Max Turbo Frequency. And there is also a performance core, efficient core, base frequency and core frequency. So many terms here, right? But then we will dig with all the details later. But right now, at least you can see, each processor has its own base frequency. So in Intel's latest architecture, we have two types of core. One is the performance core, the other is the efficient core. And what is performance core, what is efficient core? We are going to show you later. But both of them have a base frequency 3.6 and 2.7 GHz. It means that it is a normal case if we want to activate all of them at the same time. That's the base frequency. But here we see a max turbo frequency. So the max turbo frequency is that if we want to adjust the frequency, it can go up to 5 GHz. And so that's what we have. And in your assignment, you are using this processor. This is an AMD processor, and as you can see, it also jumps around 1.4 to 3.6. So every processor is now every processor adapts the mechanism to adjust the frequency dynamically. And the reason why people want to adjust the frequency dynamically is that if you look at the power consumption equation, frequency is part of it. And another thing that we talk about is that frequency and voltage, they are related. So once you want to lower the frequency, it also allows you to lower the voltage. So you can actually get a cubical reduction in the power consumption equation. So it turns out it's a very good deal for people to adjust. But as you can see, if you adjust the frequency, frequency is also part of the CPU performance equation, it will definitely hit your performance at the end. So if you're talking about energy, it's not always a good thing to lower your frequency. So it's an open problem in operating system and computer architecture research regarding how, and even data center research, regarding how we adjust the frequency to make sure that we are not slowing down too much or maximizing your battery life. And typically nowadays, people are going even more crazy using machine learning models to predict the performance and try to predict the energy. But you know, a lot of people go deep into neural networks for that solution. But to be honest, random forest is already a best solution for that. But never mind. So I think I will go into skip this because I was trying hard this morning, but I still didn't get a chance to have it successful because the new version of the Linux kernel, they have better protection about the MSR register that modern processors have. So unless you are the root of the system, it's very hard for you to access those power counters. Okay, so the very first one is very aggressive voltage frequency scaling. And the second one is actually this one, slow, but more. You might feel, what does that mean, right? So one of the paper that I'm going to, I think we have assigned, right, is single instruction set architecture, heterogeneous multi-core architecture, the potential of processor power reduction. And this is a paper in Micro 2003, and it also gets a Test of Time award from Micro in 2021. And well, you see a few other people that you are very familiar, you already seen their name. So Dean Towson, as I mentioned, he is my advisor at UC San Diego, and he invented the simultaneous multi-threading, and he is also an author. He is also the advisor of this paper. And Nong Jiaopi, you've seen his name, right? So Nong Jiaopi is the one who discovered the victim cache, if you remember. And then later on today, we are going to read another paper by Nong Jiaopi. So he is very essential. So this is actually the work Nong Jiaopi did when he is still in HP Labs, and Rakesh, he is currently a professor at UIUC. He was an intern at HP Labs at that time. And Pasta, he is right now at Google. And the reason why I got a chance to work at Google early this year is because I talked to Pasta, hey, I don't have to teach this quarter, can you give me a job? And then I got a job. He is currently the VP of Google, and he oversees a lot of things. And he was also working at HP Labs at that time, and he is more working on the system part and the data center part. So he did a lot of great job on that. But so this paper actually has a lot of people here, and but the idea of this paper is actually very simple, clever. So it's kind of from a similar observation as chip multi-core processor, is that chip multi-core processor is telling us that you can more efficiently use the die area if you don't aiming, you are not aiming for the most high performance core in a single processor, right? So the idea of this paper is also similar, right? So okay, now you are given a chip, you want to build chip multiprocessor. Do you want to put the most efficient cores, or do you want to put less efficient cores? So this one is actually giving an example. So this core names are pretty innocent to you, and I don't blame you for that, because I don't think a lot they are really into mass production at some point, because these are the cores manufactured by Digital Alpha, which is a company later acquired by Sun, and then by Oracle. And you know the notorious history of Oracle in merging and acquiring. So it's an obvious fact. So I don't want to say that, but I would say Oracle is basically a patent control company rather than a software or a system company. So the reason why they buy things is because they want to buy your patent, they want to buy your intellectual property so that they can sue other people in the same industry and get a lot of money. So that's the model of Oracle. And another thing that you will learn about Oracle, they don't really run the business very well, to be honest. But okay, but here's the thing. So this EV5, EV6, EV6 Plus, and EV8, they are the cores manufactured by Digital Alpha processor. And this square, they are here for a meaning. So their size actually means that how big their die size relatively. So an EV4 core is just this small. An EV5 core is slightly bigger than EV4. And EV6 is this big. And if you go to this one, it's actually crazily large. So what they are thinking is that, okay, if you have the budget of building a quad core EV6 processor, if you have the same area, you can actually have these options. You can put 20 EV5 cores in it, or you can selectively build 3 EV6 and 5 EV5 cores. So that's the mess that they are playing. So now thinking about this, right? You have two types of cores that you can pick, and you have this amount of area that you can use. Are you going to build a quad-core processor, a 20-core processor, or an 8-core processor with heterogeneous cores? So what's the trade-off among each? Can you tell me? right, let's wrap up in 15 seconds. Five, four, three, two, one. Time is up. Did you get it? No? Do you want to click?
Sure.
Are you done?
It's okay.
It's okay. Okay. I love you. All right. So if you look at this speaker, right, definitely a good chance to discuss with each other. So let's go for 90 seconds and you won't miss it this time.
23 were C, like about 10 were B, and like 6 were C.
I'm not sure if you said C twice.
Or D.
I said B. It was 22, I was number
criteria.
Yeah,
I was one of the 23.
Oh, C. But,
people also just pick C when they have no idea.
So, yeah. Oh, I had no idea. But
it was C.
Three sounded pretty good to me, and the rest didn't sound like good.
Yeah, I think it's definitely either 2 or 3. They're kind of like opposite, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So well, 3, 2 is
limited. It has better and then rich. It has better on the
modules. Yeah, I feel like women did really better on the modules. Better on the
okay.
Well,
I'm pretty sure one of those is true.
Yeah. So
I can say one for those, and the other one's not true.
Yeah.
So then it's either one.
Four
is like obviously
wrong.
Four, I have no idea, but that
why would you want to prioritize?
All right, 15 seconds. Five, four, three, two, one. Time is up. Okay, let's see. What's after discussion? Okay, so Lauren, you think is C, so. Two of those, you guys think is correct. So let's take a look of what you guys think. So for single instruction set heterogeneous multi-core architectures, do you need to recompile and optimize the binary for each core architecture to exploit the thread level parallelism in this architecture?
No.
No? Why not?
Not necessary.
Not necessary. Why is this not as necessary?
Some central location has it compiled and optimized already.
So what's the meaning of compiler? Why do we need to compile our program from where to where?
From like programming language to assembly code?
To assembly code or say machine instructions, right? So with single instruction set architecture, heterogeneous chip multiprocessor, do we change the machine instructions?
No.
No, right? So that's actually the whole point of single ISA, because you are under the same umbrella of computer instructions. So there's no demand. I mean, you can definitely try to optimize your binary, but it doesn't matter that much. And in fact, the hardware design won't take any benefit from there, because if you think about it's more about how you write your code rather than how you compile your code, right? And the hardware already, like with the logic of out-of-order execution, we already know how to exploit the instruction level parallelism implicitly in a processor. And a lot of stuff actually compiler doesn't help. For example, compiler don't do dynamic loop unrolling because they don't have branch prediction. You can definitely do static loop unrolling, but once you have done that, right, it doesn't matter because different architecture, it will optimize internally, right? So as long as you can compile your program into the same instruction set architecture that all cores are running, you don't have to have various binary versions of binary to run on this processor. So that's the neat part of this design, right? So the same program will work on this heterogeneous cores. Because what really different is the microarchitecture of each core, but not the instruction set architecture of each core. Okay, so the first one is wrong. For program with limited threat level parallelism, single instruction set architecture heterogeneous CMP would deliver better or at least the same levels of performance than homogeneous chip only processor. True or false?
Seems true.
You don't know?
False.
Andy? False. Okay, Jonathan?
False.
Okay, I will say this is true. And, okay, so that's why. Okay, so here's the thing, right? For heterogeneous multiprocessors, right? The good thing is that we have performance cores and efficient cores. Right. So, oh yeah, I should mention, I think I forgot to mention, those bigger cores, they are actually more performant. And and it's kind of very interesting, right? So computer scientists, or computer engineers, we kind of like hide our shortage with some more elegant terms. So I would say those low performance cores, right? But if you say it's a low performance core, then people are not happy with them. So those smaller cores, they are indeed lower performant, but we are calling them efficient cores because they are indeed more efficient if you look at power, right? So that's more power efficient core. So performance core and efficient cores, right? And so here's the thing. If you have limited threat level parallelism, it means that you only have very limited amount of threat that you are going to spawn at the same time. So in this way, right, you can schedule those threats on those performance cores instead of using those efficient cores. And when you are using the performance core, you are effectively doing the same thing as running the program on a giant homogeneous performance multi-core processors. So that's why this question, I would say the answer is yes. For a program with rich threat level parallelism, single instruction set architecture heterogeneous multi-chip multiprocessor will deliver better or at least the same level performance than homogeneous chip-only processor built with older generation cores. So if you have rich threat level parallelism, it means that you have a lot of threats, right? And here we say, the same level performance than with older generation cores. So here is saying that compare against a processor, like a 20 core processor you have, right? But those 20 core processors, they are slower processor. If you have rich threat parallelism, which one is better? And I want to say, the answer would be, it depends. So, for example, if your threat, each thread is really, really ILP limited, instruction level parallelism limited. Even though you give the thread rich instruction level parallelism that typically a performance core will provide, it doesn't help. But in the meantime, as the problem says, this program has a lot of threads. So if I can give the thread, if I can give the program more threads in the meantime, it will be helping more, right? So for this question, I would say it totally depends on what each thread inside there looks like. But in a case that we demonstrate, right, it's a 20 core versus 8 cores, and it's very hard for an 8 core processor to bid 20 core processor if you are having a program with a lot of threads. Okay. Spending more instruction on old generation cores would always lead to better energy delay. So for this question, this statement, I would say it's a false, because again, energy, right? Energy is okay. So energy consumption is execution time times power, right? So unless the efficient core has significantly lower power and won't cause the execution time to go up a lot, you will have better energy efficiency. Otherwise, it's not going to be true. And for this paper in particular, they don't use the energy as the only metric. They use energy delay because they want to tell you that we want to increase the weight of delay, which is the execution time in those programs. So that is telling you it's only good if you don't slow down your program too much. And it turns out that if you look at the result of the paper, they are trying to convince you that the energy delay of the chip multiprocessor design they have, heterogeneous chip multiprocessor design, is always better than this ABA-minus design, right? And they also have a breakdown of this, and if you check the execution in detail, it doesn't always mean that spending more time on lower performance core will give you better energy savings. So for this example, you only save 27%. But for this one, you spend less amount of time on EV6, but you actually get 43% of the energy saving, right? So that those are evidence why the statement that we have seen in the fourth one is incorrect. Okay, so here is actually the performance breakdown when we talk about the first two statements. So the first statement is talking about the case where we have limited parallelism. So when we say limited parallelism, let's say your program has less than four threads, fewer than four threads. And as you can see, this solid line, which is the case, we have a quad-core processor with all performance core, is always better than the heterogeneous core that we have. However, if you look at the thread level parallelism beyond four, then turns out that, well, with this heterogeneous course, we are actually going to keep scaling, but the performance processor is staying here, right? So it's not going any better if we don't give the program more cores. In the meantime, so that's what I'm saying, if your program has a rich thread level parallelism, right, then it go with this purple line, right? It will go up to 20 because you have 20 cores. So even though it's always slower below 12 thread, but if your thread level parallelism is richer than that, you are going to win. So this is the heterogeneous chip multiprocessor with a single instruction set architecture. And you might feel like, is this paper far away from us? And the answer is no. If you have an Intel 12th generation processor, which is exactly the processor that I use a lot in the demo, you will see that their core architecture actually has the P cores, which they mark as P here, and efficient cores, which they mark as E here. And if you have an Apple iPhone or an Apple silicon powered laptop, this is your processor. And if you look at the processor, they also have four P cores plus four E cores in each of the processor die, right? So single instruction set architecture, heterogeneous chip multiprocessor is everywhere. And now I'm going to show you, it's actually a huge pain if you want to optimize your performance on these platforms.
So let me show you the demo. Hello? Hello? Okay, so. Courses 203 demo. I'm going to show you the big detail core. Okay, so I'm going to show you a few demos. So this is the histogram program that you have been used in your assignment 4. And if you still don't know what a histogram program is doing, I think you are in trouble. Okay, so let me run this program and then let's see what it would generate. So what I'm going to do is that, okay, first of all, this is a histogram with optimized block. As you experienced already, and then I'm going to draw the figure exactly like what we have done in your assignment. And here, we just don't do anything. We just let the operating system decide how to schedule your thread. And here is the speed up we got, right? So as it's probably not too a surprise to you, the histogram only get like twice speed up with 4 threads. Right, so but remember this, that's probably that's something that's memorized for now. So let me see. Yeah, the speed up is about like 1.8, right? So now in Linux, there is a program called TaskSet that would allow you to fix the assignment, the set of processors that you can use when you are running a program. So for this particular case, right now, I'm running the program using core ID 0246 until 14, the even number. So there are 8 of this. And the reason why I picked those ones is not a random. So first of all, in Linux core assignment, the core ID 0 and core ID 1, they will share the same physical core. And 0 and 1, they are actually coming from simultaneous multi-threading. Because what would really happen is that, you know, those architects, we are so nice. We don't want the operating system people. We don't want to bother the operating system people. So what turns out is that, okay, when we rolling out this simultaneous multi-threading technology or hyper-threading technology, we actually pretend there are 2 physical cores by providing a full set of architectural features that to the Linux cores. So Linux kernel. So they will consider each core as a homogeneous core in this way, regardless if both of them are sharing the same pipeline. So it turns out that 0 and 1, they are sharing the same pipeline. 2 and 3, they are sharing the same pipeline. So that's why I only pick this odd even number, because when you do this, you can make sure that each of them are running on a different physical cores. So let me keep running it and let's see what the performance looks like. So okay, so the arrangement of Linux cores is right now for performance core, they are ranking from 0, starting from 0, and followed by those efficient cores. And for this processor, it's a Core i7 12th generation processor that I would have. Okay, so now let's compare it. So, okay, so the right 4 are the ones that I only use P cores. So, by only use P cores, I get like 1.8 times speed up, which is very close to the case where I allow the processor to randomly select. And you might ask why randomly select is doing a better job. So a few potential reasons. So first of all, if the operating system randomly picks, then it's typically the case that we are going to use simultaneous multi-threading. So when you use simultaneous multi-threading, there are pros and cons. So the pros are you allow threads to share caches. And for our case, it's definitely helpful because you are doing a lot of locking and data sharing. So if you allow them to share the L1 cache, you are actually reduce the chances of coherent misses because they are physically the same cache. So that's why if you allow the processor to render, they would potentially leverage simultaneous multi-threading. And if your per thread instruction level parallelism is not a lot, it won't actually hurt your performance too much. So that's why you see the random assignment is actually doing a slightly better job than putting stuff only on performance cores. But what I really want you to know is this. Right now, I set my task at 16, 17, 18, and 19. So they are the efficient cores provided on the Intel 12th generation processor. And they are actually the Skylake architecture, which is a long time ago, probably the 7th generation of Intel processor or the 6th generation, right? The 6th generation of the Intel processor. I mean, 7 is also right because it's TikTok. What?
7 is KB Lake.
Okay, KB Lake, right? So, okay, so it's the 6th generation processor. And now, let me show you what the performance looks like. Okay, if I'm only running threads on efficient cores, these are the right 4. This is what I end up getting. I'm getting slower per thread performance. So here is also a good reference point, right? The performance ratio between the performance core and efficient core is 1 versus 0.5. For this particular program, it's 5% slower. And when you put it in multi-threaded setup, it's actually going to be 1.4 times only if you can use all these 4 efficient cores, right? So one thing you will feel is that, okay, there's non-determinism in thread distribution order. There's also non-determinism in per-thread performance because within the same processor, you might have to be scheduled onto a different core, and the performance difference is that significant, right? It's significant enough that you can tell. So that's what we get in E-core only. And you know, half and half, a lot of cases you like half and half, right? So right now I pick 2 of the cores from the P-core and 2 of the cores from the E-core. And let's see what's going on. Half and half, how much time it takes to run. Okay, with half and half, this is what we get. See, we get the speed up to 1.75, right? Very close to the 1.8 that we got in okay. Yeah, okay, so anyway, this one, right? So when you do half and half, it's very close to the 1.8 that we got when we're doing performance core only, right? So it means that, you know, when you perform like thread scheduling nowadays, you have more things to deal with, even though the assignment of your processor cores, right? Okay, another thing that I want to talk about, right now we are at the strategy called slower but more. So back to the 1,000 core story. So if you remember what I taught in the last time, a friend of mine who is currently in Microsoft, like he was telling me, okay, I think the future is going to be a 1,000 core processor future. To be honest, it's possible, but what is 1,000 core processor in the future? So if you look at this, this is by Intel's most recent Sapphire Rapid spec. And okay, look at the number of cores from left to right. We are increasing the number of cores. Now, look at the base frequency. We are going from, we are also going down from right to left, right? What does that mean? And just look at the power consumption, right? The leftmost one, it has 350. So we are actually giving it more power. Even though we have done that, the performance per core has to go down because we have limited power consumption available when you are designing chips for heat dissipation. Right. So what does that mean? Yes, it's possible you build thousands of cores, but each of the cores has to be very, very slow. Slow enough to not making good progress on your code, unless it's a highly parallel program. Did you see that? So the problem here is that, okay, if you just want to build an 8-core processor, each core can run at 3.7 gigahertz. But if you want to build a 60-core processor, it's not impossible, but each core is only at 1.9 gigahertz. And that's all because of the dark silicon problem. Because if we go even further, then the power consumption is going up more. And most of the heat sink that you have nowadays on your motherboard can only dissipate about like 125 watts, and this one is already going up to 195. So you have to use a heat pipe with very high speed fan, which make your data center server really loud. So there is a data center, a machine room we have in Winston Chongho, which we host most of your server that assignment uses. Every time when I go in there, you have to wear a earplug, noise cancellation headphone to make sure that it doesn't hurt your ears because the noise is really, really noisy. Right. So maybe one thing that I could do the next time is that if I found some people cheating, just have them sitting in the room for maybe an hour, right? And then you will never do that in the future, right? But here's the thing, right? So with more cores per chip, you have to make each core slower to fulfill the heat dissipation requirement because of dark silicon. Okay, so, and long time ago, Intel has a Xeon Phi processor. It has 72 cores, but if you look at the basic frequency and the turbo frequency, it's also 1.6 gigahertz. Okay, so one thing that I don't have a slide for, but I think you should really know, is when you look at the Intel processor spec, there is a turbo boost. How can I clear all this? There is a turbo boost technology. So the meaning of turbo boost technology, well, we can talk about this later. Okay, sorry. I thought I should talk about it here. All the mechanism that we are talking about, right, is lower the frequency, making your code slower, or put more efficient cores. So all of this is also trying to help us in dynamic power. But none of the techniques that we are talking about is reducing leakage power. So leakage power is the power consumption when your circuit is on duty. You have to consume. So for example, if you are using this hardware, to retain the data that you need. But static power, right? Whenever you want to do this, it's always there if you have the circuit power on. So another trend that can actually address the static power, which is a little bit sad, is that sometimes if you cannot change the world, let's just accept the fact. Right? So the trend that I'm going to talk about is just let it dark. What does that mean by just let it dark?
I misplaced one of the put up the right slide. Give me a second.
not showing up here. Oh, here we go. Okay. So maybe the order should be changed. Okay, but before we talk about it, right? Another trend of slower but more is actually GPU. So this is the architecture of Ampere, not the latest Hopper. And for Ampere architecture, this is the design of their processor, and each of this is a, I think I made it. Okay, so sorry. Each of this small one, is a string multiprocessor. So what is, so this is actually a many core processor. And if you check the speed of each of the processor, it's also running at a lower speed that you could imagine. So let me check this. So okay, so on the computer that I'm using, or say on the processor, on the cluster that you are using, right? If you try to use NVIDIA-SMI-A, you are actually having a process, a GPU with NVIDIA's Ampere architecture, which is identical to the graph that I show you. And if you look at the speed of this Ampere processor, Ampere GPU, let's see. Okay, it's very power efficient, 70 watt. But the cost of this 70 watt is that your graphics clock can only be 1.2 gigahertz. You are running your processors at 1.2 gigahertz, that's how you get the power consumption. And on the machine that I performed the demo, if you do NVIDIA SMI, I have a Turing architecture, which is an older architecture. And for this one, you actually have processors, stream multiprocessors, running at 2.1 gigahertz. But if you look at the power consumption, it's actually going to be 250, right? So a lot of you think, okay, you don't compare things act to act. So let me change the machine that I'm using. So let's see which machine that I have has a better one. Ampere, so probably this one. Okay, so this is another one is with Ampere architecture. And if you look at the frequency of this one, power draw, right? 400. And the frequency of this one is put 2.1 because it has many, many processors, right? So one thing you can find is that, right? For if you want to lower the power consumption, you really have to lower your frequency of your processor. And a lot of you would think, okay, GPUs, they are really fast because we have very efficient cores. And the answer is no. You have a lot of slow cores, right? 2.1 compared against your GPU frequency, a CPU frequency is very low. However, the reason why GPU has better performance is because if you look at this, right, the design of their processor is composed of many stream multiprocessors. And each of the stream multiprocessor is actually looking like this. So if you look at the design of a stream multiprocessor, they have a total of 64 FP32 cores and 64 integer 32 cores, or 16 double cores. So what does that mean by this? But what's the difference between this cores and processor cores? So you might feel that, okay, I have an integer course, I have a floating point course. But the design of GPU course is actually, why am I putting them together? Why am I putting them together? Is this 64 cores, they can only do the same operation at the same time. So when you put an add instruction into floating point cores, they can only work on floating point addition, subtraction at the same time. They cannot work on their individual instructions at the same time. Because for the SM design, all of the three multiprocessors, they share the same instruction scheduler, the same instruction unit, the same control, so that they can save the area of issuing logic, right, as we mentioned. So that within the same die area, they can have more functional units available. But in the meantime, the parallelism they can actually provide is that you have a lot of data coming in. They can all perform the same operation at the same time. So this is another level parallelism that we didn't talk a lot in this quarter, because I think we have a GPU programming class which would teach you more. This is called data level parallelism, which means that different data, they all work on the same instructions at the same time. So that's the data level parallelism that GPU can provide. And another thing which you might hear is that, okay, when I can only ask the GPU to work on integers instructions at the same time, or floating point at the same time, what does that mean? When I am only working on floating point workloads, I can actually turn off my integer unit. When I am working on double precision numbers, I can actually turn off my floating point and integer unit. And there's also another thing which you might find here. It's called tensor cores. So this is another type of hardware component that NVIDIA hardware has as a stand-up. This is an accelerator for matrix multiplier and multiplications. And the usage model of tensor cores is pretty much like this. So first of all, you have to specifically set the handle, or in the CUDA programming model, to tell you, I'm going to use tensor cores. Which means that, okay, since I'm going to use tensor cores, the rest of the circuit is okay to disable now. And then, you have to convert the number to 16-bit, because tensor cores is actually designed for AI ML accelerations. So you can you actually want to make it so if we want to design this accelerator to be efficient, then 16-bit is good enough. And finally, called GMM or whatever WMA interface you want to use for tensor cores. But in the meantime, when you do this, the floating point cores, they are not in use. So that, which means that, okay, GPU actually takes the design. If you are not in use of those functional units, they are dark. Because if you power up all of them, it's going to be a disaster. It's not happening, right? So GPU actually took this design. We can only turn on each of the functional units at the same time. Okay, so tensor core, we just mentioned, it's actually also fulfilling the fourth trend that we are seeing in computer architecture design, called the rise of ASICs. So what is ASICs? It's application-specific integrated circuits. So application-specific, it means that I'm designing a hardware that can only perform spatial functions. So what's the benefit of it? So saying that, so if you have took undergrad architecture, you're probably familiar with the five-stage pipeline design. So saying that, if I want to perform AI plus equal to AI plus 1 times 20, some kind of scaling operation that you may be using, then if you want to do this with RISC-V, you will need 6 instructions. And these 6 instructions, it will need this amount of circuits as a pipeline processor.
But no, if today I said that I only want to design a processor, perform this task. I want to have a hardware that only does this, right? Do I need all of them? Right, so let's think about it, right? Do I need to have instruction fetch unit? Do I need to have an instruction fetch unit? You don't, right? Because when something comes in, you know, okay, I'm doing this. This is the only thing I can do. Life becomes easy and simple, right? So you don't need the instruction fetch unit, even you have a fixed function. So this part can be gone. Okay. Do I need to have very complex logic of hazard detection, control logic? No. And I only have fixed number of registers that I need to use, right? So we don't need complex control. We don't need to decode either because we have only one type of instruction. So we don't need this. And ALUs, right? We only need the ones that we need. It could be an adder in this case. So the rest of them, skip. All right. So finally, that's with the remaining part, you can further rearrange the data paths to be pipelined. And each of the pipeline stage is shorter, so your frequency can potentially be even higher if you want, right? And turns out the frequency could be even higher, or and your hardware could be a lot simpler because you can actually now put a lot of them onto the same core, right? With the same amount of transistors, which would consume equally amount of power that you need with higher parallelism, right? So each stage can be as fast as a pipeline processor, and each stage can work on different data for this accelerated instruction. So that's the power of ASICs, right? So an example of implementation of the ASICs is actually Google's Tensor Processing Unit. And that's what I, one of the project that I work, a project that I work related to this hardware when I worked at Google. So, but this paper was published a long time ago. All right, Noam Jopi, right? He is here again. Right, so Tensor Processing Unit is actually also one of his products. So, Tensor Processing Unit, I don't know how many of you really go into the paper, but I do have a few things that I want you to think. Let's wrap up in 15 seconds. Five, four, three, two, one. Time is up. Okay, so look at your, okay, so do it looks like we need some discussions, right? So go ahead and discuss with your friends for another 90 seconds and let's see what you guys have. Go. I don't know.
because there wasn't.
I agree with you.
I said it probably wasn't.
I said it probably wasn't.
If you say it wasn't orange, then you say it is too.
Because both of those have to do with me.
Sending instructions to the TV.
I think one is true. I don't think two is true.
All right, let's wrap up in 15 seconds. Five, four, three, two, one. Time is up. Okay, so after discussion, this is what I got. That was more amusing to see. So, okay, so let me see what you guys have. Is TPU optimized for highly accurate matrix multiplications? Yes, no? How precise the, what's the precision of their matrix multipliers? 16-bit in the first version of the TPU. But why they make that decision? What? Because of what?
Speed.
But why they can make that decision? Maybe I should ask about this.
Deep learning.
It's deep learning, right? A lot of people were saying, well, deep learning, there must be something really smart and precise and intelligent. The answer is no. Actually, in machine learning, we are very error tolerant. Right, like, okay, what happened if ChatGPT doesn't give you a right answer? LOL, right? And what if the face ID doesn't recognize me? I would do it again, right? And if it doesn't work out, I would type my password. Do you feel angry about that? You don't, right? And sometimes if you do voice control over your GPS, when you are driving, if it doesn't recognize what you said, which happens a lot in my life, what do you blame? For me, I would blame, is it because I have some accent, right? So those companies, they are really smart. They know people are very tolerant to errors from machine learning. So, and if you think about the hardware cost of building a 32-bit floating point multiplier, it's actually four times more than a 16-bit one. So instead of using full 32-bit precision, most of the accelerators, machine learning accelerators, although they do matrix multiplications, but they only do matrix multiplication in a very limited degree of precision. So Tensor cores, they do 16 bits. And the first version of the TPU, they also focus on inferencing, so they only do 16 bit. And what happened is that we quantize user data and make them 16 bit and perform matrix multiplications to do the inferencing, and turns out if the result doesn't is not correct, okay, people will deal with it. So in fact, right, this is only possible if you are designing this hardware for this like specific type of hardware application. So because it's designed for this specific type of applications, so they can make their matrix multiplier less precise. Is it designed for sparse matrix multiplications? What? Yes or no? So the answer is also no. So a lot of people would think, well, dense matrix multiplication is a little bit overkill, but the answer is sparse matrix multiplication is just slow for a variety of reasons. So a lot of people spending a lot of time trying to optimize your code and trying to exploit the sparsity of your code. And I would say this is something like Winlist for now. It's good, theoretically, but in terms of performance, terrible idea. And the reason is because the cost of making your matrix sparse is actually really huge. And the other thing is that although you can save a lot of multiplications, but that's only true when you are in the era of CPUs, when you are in the era of serialized execution. If you are doing sparse matrix multiplication, because you have a huge step that you have to decide if I have to do multiplications or not, it actually kills the parallelism that you have in your code. So it turns out sparse matrix multiplication is not a good way. And TPU reduce the IC of the performance equation? Yes or no? Yes, right? And that's why all the hardware accelerator works. Because like the example that I show you, originally you have 6 instructions, now it's only 1. And each of the instructions can be even further pipeline. So that's the good thing about ASICs. All TPU instructions are equally long. The answer is no. Because some of the TPU instructions, they are shorter. Some of the TPU instructions, they are really long. So there is a very interesting discussion in this paper because one of the authors is actually Debbie Patterson and John Hennessy. And they are the ones who invented RISC-V. Tell people that you should make your instruction equally long. But then they actually make an argument that why this instruction has to be different lengths. Okay, so there are a lot of very interesting discussions that you will see in this paper, and fallacies and pitfalls pretty similar to what you have in the textbook. So, but it's worth spending your time reading those. And you might feel like, okay, is accelerators away from me? So in fact, if you are right now having an Apple processor, right, if you look at their die carefully, then like, okay. So in addition to performance core and efficient cores, they have this neural engine. They are pretty much like the TPUs or tensor cores that you have. And don't forget, GPUs, they are originally just an accelerator for games. Right? A lot of people forget that GPU is initially a gaming processor, gaming accelerator, right? And even for Intel processor nowadays, you see there is a Gaussian neural accelerator. So every processor you have right now is actually a small system on chip with accelerators equipped. So, and even in cloud servers, we are trying to build as many accelerations as possible. So, for companies that do not have a lot of resources of building their own chips, they sometimes would opt to have FPGAs, which is a programmable but also spatialized circuits that is actually a container of lots of lookup tables. And these lookup tables would actually help to implement the logic that you need for your specific applications. So you can actually prototype or create an ASIC-like processor with FPGA. And Microsoft has significantly demonstrated and deployed the use of FPGAs to power their machine learning infrastructure in their data center. So as you can see, if you use Bing search, it's already being accelerated using FPGA. And their deep neural network has been accelerated. And they also accelerated their SQL services provided in the Microsoft Azure cloud. So And they have many different generations of this. And so those slides, and the reason why they pick FPGAs versus ASICs is because for those ASICs, once you manufacture the chip, it's almost impossible for you to alter the function. But for FPGA, you can always reconfigure the content of the lookup table to perform different functions. So that's the benefit of using FPGAs. However, because FPGAs, they are indeed not specialized circuits, and they have to implement everything as lookup tables. So you're not going to get performance benefit in terms of latency. And in fact, if you dig into the paper carefully, they tell you it's actually going to be slower if you perform jobs like decryption or encryption. But the good thing is that if you use your processor, which is very, very expensive to perform encryption and decryption, then your processor cannot do anything else for your customers. So a few final words. I want to talk about this. So a lot of people in computer science or computer engineering only think software is the only future. And today I'm going to tell you the era has ended. And it's now the golden age of computer architecture, because becoming a programmer, just writing program, that's very easy. But if you want to become a performance programmer, which is really the ones who can make values for your company, it's very difficult. For example, in the class, we have demonstrated that branch prediction caches instruction level parallelism. They have huge impact on your performance. And if you just program at a level of TensorFlow, you're not going to leverage all of those, right? And we are right now in a multi-core era. A lot of us only think about the algorithm complexity, but that's actually not the only thing you should care about in the era of multi-core. And multi-core era, you will have a lot of you will have a lot of coherent or consistency bugs. And we are right now in a dark silicon era, and we need to write. And in a dark silicon era, there are a lot of implications. Single core performance is not getting any faster, right? You have heard this a lot. And multi-core doesn't scale anymore because the era of dark silicon. We are seeing more and more ASICs. But what does that mean? We need more system-level programmers to use these new ASICs. Because they have new instructions, they have new facilities. We need people to write compilers. We need people to write low-level assembly code. We need people to tell the hardware designer what spec we like. So one thing I have done a lot is that we have to talk to the team who developed the Tensor processors to tell them, okay, these are the potential features that we want in the future. Can we make this the hardware in the next generation of Google's Tensor processor? So the software programmer has to know what kind of hardware we want and even dive into the detail of the hardware design now and revise the application design to leverage the new features that hardware has. And if you are just programming at a very high level, you're not going to make your program highly performant. And higher performance, lower energy means more income or more operation loss for the company. And every company wants it. So that's why I think it's the golden age of computer architects, because it's really the time. You cannot be a solo programmer. You have to know a lot of the architecture as well. All right, so one thing before we jump into the end of the quarter is that, first of all, thank you all for the great quarter, and we want to take a group photo together. And our TA is right here to help out. Actually, we should have our TA. So what I want to do is that everyone can come up and we can take a group photo together. I actually have this. So, I can't do this one.
access can get to it. Okay, everyone come up. So that's the best way of, you know, it's better than the sign up sheet. And we will match you guys with the photo provided on e-learning. Okay. Come on. Okay, we need more people on that side. Yes, that side is also possible. Okay, let's do it real quick. A lot of people, yeah, more than I would imagine. I thought this is the last class. All right, are you guys ready? Coming. All right, okay. Try to smile. Yeah, done. Done. Yeah, we have it. It's like a magic. All right, then some more things. Not yet. Okay, so you know, I was born at the age that we still have Steve Jobs. And one thing I'm most excited about every time when I see Steve Jobs is just one more thing. So one more thing is actually not very exciting. So we are going to talk about final. So the final exam will be held at, I think it's Barnes, B118, and not yet. It starts at 11:30 a.m. and similar to the midterm, but more time and about 1.5 times longer in length. Two of the problem sets will be comprehensive exam questions. You should arrive earlier. And because there's a 30-minute gap between this exam and the last exam, I would suggest you to come by at least 15 minutes early before the test, because what we are going to do is that we are going to hand in the exam one by one. And you come by, so the process is that you come by the TA, one of the TA will give you one, and the other assistant would assign you a seat. And because it's a huge room, we have 300 seats. So we want to make sure that you don't have anyone around you. And if you come in a group, we will make sure that we will separate each of you. And so that's why it takes time. And you have to take your own risk if you arrive on time or late, because you still have to go through the same process, and we are going to collect your exam by 2:30. So if you cannot get it down by 2:30, it's your responsibility. There is no extension of your time for sure. You cannot change the assignment meeting. You can not bring any outside material, scratch paper. We will provide if necessary. You need to prepare your own calculator if you think you need a calculator. And we have talked about this a week ago, right? So you can definitely buy one from Amazon. Simple final, 15 questions in multiple choices, free answer question, open-ended question with two problem sets, two open-ended questions, 8 questions in total. So two of them are the comprehensive exam questions. And here are the guidelines of answering questions. So we have some sample ones which you can experience. And also we have free answer questions. So first of all, as I mentioned in the class, register renaming out of order execution is the main part of modern processor. So if I give you the C code, can you tell me what the average CPU? If I give you this piece of code, can you tell me what kind of cache do you need
to have the performance best. If I give you this access sequence, I give you the hit rate, can you tell me what's the cache configuration? Open-ended questions. Okay, code cache miss rate, branch predictions, SMT versus CMP, which one is better? Okay, most important thing. I'm going to assign a few more papers to you. And I would like to go through it and read it. And I'm going to ask you exactly the same question as I listed here. And the other thing is that don't discuss this with others. If I found two people as identical or similar answers, because it's the end of the quarter, I will just directly send it to Ms. Conducting office. And I'm sure if you are graduating this quarter, if you are involved in this issue, they won't let you graduate. And other open-ended questions, which some of them we just talked about, right? So yeah, that's pretty much it. And we do have our last office hours listed here. And the dropping policy is clear here, all right? So you will see those threads online. And thank you all for participating in this quarter. It's really great to have you guys.